brought to you by Sunbeam, the best electric shavers made. Makers of the new Sunbeam Rollmaster electric shaver with self-adjusting rollers that automatically adjust to your face and beard. Now, let's all play What's My Line?
And now let's meet our award-winning What's My Line panel. First, the popular columnist whose voice of Broadway appears in papers coast to coast, Miss Dorothy Kilgallen.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. And here's someone that we're always delighted to have sitting in the chair next to me. He's an Academy Award winner and the star of the current film, Happy Anniversary, Mr. David Niven.
If you're in show business, one of the nicest byproducts of it is the group that one works and plays with. And one of the best products and most lovable products out of that byproduct is Miss Arlene Francis.
And now our Random House publisher, contributor to This Week magazine, columnist, Mr. Bennett, sir.
Here's one of the greatest panel moderators in television. In fact, one of the few who's left, Mr. John Charles Daly.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to What's My Line, and welcome to David Niven, back on the panel again. He always adds a lot of life and laughter to it, and it's a pleasure, particularly, to puzzle his brains out for the better part of a half an hour, which is what we intend to do tonight. We will also have a famous mystery guest before the panel a little bit later in the show, and we'll meet our first challenger after. And now let's meet our first contestant. Will you come in and sign in, please? Norma? Norma Brooks, is that right? Is it Miss or Mrs. Brooks?
Mrs.
Mrs. Brooks?
Yes.
Mrs. Brooks, may I present the panel? Panel, may I present Mrs. Brooks? Could you join me over here, please? Now, Mrs. Brooks, do you know how we keep score?
Yes, I do.
You know how we keep score? We'll let the folks at home and those who've been good enough to come and join us in the theater audience know exactly what your line is. Right now, panel, Mrs. Brooks, we can tell you, is salaried, and we'll begin the general questioning with Bennett, sir.
Mrs. Brooks, I can tell you one thing before we start. There are going to be lots of conferences tonight. May I ask you, since you are about the prettiest contestant we've had in a long time, whether you have anything whatever to do with the world of entertainment?
No.
A very good question. One down and nine to go, Miss Kilgallen.
Mrs. Brooks, do you work for a profit-making organization?
Yes.
Can both men and women enjoy what you do?
Yes.
Well, I don't even have to ask whether men would enjoy it more than women. Could even children enjoy what you do?
Yes.
Is there a product involved in what you do?
No.
That makes it two down. Mr. Niven.
As the normal panel can spot a line tamer,
of your...
You looked a little shaken then, John. I wasn't sure that. And are you an outdoor girl in your work?
No.
That makes it 4 down and 6 to go, Miss French.
No, that's only 2 down.
2 down. 1, 2, 3. That's right. 3 down and 7.
Make with the money, John.
Well, these are all mixed up. We'll just throw those over. Forget about it. Somebody. Yeah, this is fun. Let's have some fun. Little things that we've been on. Well, we've been doing this program nearly 10 years. For the first time in 10 years, these have been put on backwards. I see what you should see. Well, I got my pencil and my card out, and I'm keeping the score. It's 3 down and 7 to go, Miss Francis.
Well, now, Mr. Niven has found out that you use one part of your body more than another part of your body.
Out of water.
Out of water. Thank you, Niven. Is the part of the body that you use more than the other the lower part of your body?
No.
4 down and 6 to go, Mr. Sir.
Mrs. Brooks, let's get into more mental things. Do you use your brain more than your body for the work that you do?
Bennett, this would be very difficult for Mrs. I would say this. It's in that old tradition. It's a fine question, Bennett. I want you to know that. It's a
good
question.
Go on, have
question.
A conference, John.
I can't. I'm waiting for an excuse to have a conference, but I can't yet. I haven't had one. I would say this, that Mrs. Brooks certainly uses her brain continuously, as I think we would also agree she must continuously use her physical skills in performing the service. Would you agree with that?
That's right.
Yes. Too bad. Brooks. I was hoping you'd disagree and we could have a conference. Well, that's life. All right, Bennett.
Do you come into direct contact, Mrs. Brooks, with the people that you are servicing? Was there any particular reason why Mr. Daly didn't tell us where you came from?
No.
Kansas City, Kansas.
You didn't say so.
Well, I know. That just worries you. That's all. That's why.
Mrs. Brooks, are you connected in a service that requires some kind of special education?
No.
Well, now, may we have a conference? Thank you.
She got her out of work.
Bennett, Mrs. Brooks is being very generous, and I'm sure you will appreciate that. There is a degree of special training which would come under the general heading of education, which does not imply, nevertheless, that there has to be a formal degree type of training, but special training is necessary.
You do need special training. Mrs. Brooks, have you anything whatever to do with transportation, either on the surface or up and down?
No,
that's 5 down and 5 to go, Miss Kilgallen.
Mrs. Brooks, may we agree, or if not, would you straighten me out, that the arms and hands are part of the upper part of the body?
That's right.
We once had a little trouble over that. Is that more than other parts of your body in your work?
Yes.
As well as your brain. Since there is no product, do your hands or arms move around in your work?
Yes.
Do you touch something with them?
Yes.
Is this something with movable parts?
Sometimes.
Well, is it now, or has it ever been alive?
Well, this gets to be very difficult, doesn't it, after a while? Sometimes, I think, is the answer to that, don't you? Yes, sometimes.
Well, is it in the very broadest sense of the word, in the animal kingdom? And I include human beings in that.
You saved yourself that time. Carry on.
Well, what else?
Well, I just don't like to think of... Well,
we're not
I mean,
vegetables.
A nice panel like you all being animal. I really don't like to think about it in that term.
Well,
comes along, more animal than others.
Do the people to whom you render your services come in direct contact with them?
Yes, I do.
Do your hands touch them?
Yes.
Would it be possible for a man to do what you do?
It's possible.
Would you say that there were more women doing what you do than men?
Yes.
Do you touch them above the waist?
Yes.
Do you touch them... Do you touch them above the neck?
Yes.
Do you have anything to do with the area of the mouth?
Yes.
Do you work in or around a dentist's office?
Yes.
Are you?
Yes.
Are you a dental assistant or a laboratory
right.
assistant?
Right!
John, Betty, who are watching this program, I think Mrs. Brooks ought to tell the name of the dentist she works for.
I'd be very happy to. I work for Dr. T.J. Nidifer. He's an oral surgeon.
And you know, it's a very lucky thing that Bennett doesn't live in Kansas City. He wouldn't have a tooth in his head by now.
Thank you very much, ma'am. We had a wonderful time in your office. Thank you very much.
Let's meet our second challenge. Over here, do you know how we keep score, Mrs. Swart?
Yes, sir.
Good. In that event, we'll let everybody in the audience here in the theater and those at home know exactly what your line is. All right. Panel, I will tell you that Mr. Swart is salaried, and let's begin the general questioning with Dorothy Kilgallen.
Mr. Swart, do you work for a profit-making organization?
Yes.
Is there a product in what you do?
Yes.
Is it a useful product?
Yes.
Would you say that I might have this product in my home? I have rather a large house.
I would say... actually, Dorothy, this would depend on a set of circumstances. You could. Mr. Swartz would not be aware, actually, if all the circumstances necessary to your having it are fulfilled. So we'll say you could have it.
Is this solid rather than liquid?
Solemn.
I don't know that I even asked Prada. Oh, yes, I did. It's solid. Could I hold it in my hand?
Yes.
If it were in the house, would it be out of sight most of the time? In a closet or in a drawer or a cupboard?
Yes.
Is this consumed?
Mr. Niven.
Well, it's eaten by the animal kingdom, to coin a phrase, isn't it?
Yes.
Four-legged animals.
Yes.
Animals that, if I was standing up, would be below my knee.
You were lucky.
Yes.
All right.
I got a hundred...
Said, dogs.
Pardon?
A dog?
Yes.
Oh,
yes,
listen,
sir.
I'm great.
Go ahead,
gentlemen. Something that is consumed by dogs, dog food of a sort.
Dog no. food of a sort? That's no. That's two down and eight to go.
Consumed by dogs and isn't dog food. What eating is that?
It'll all come out in the wash.
But it is something a dog puts in his mouth. Or her mouth.
Well, it's put in the dog's mouth, you know, or something. That last
yes.
dog, I had a little trouble with a knife and fork.
It was doing swallow it.
Would a dog that didn't know what he was doing swallow it?
It isn't something that a dog would ferret out for itself. It is something you give a dog.
Yes.
Uh-huh. Is it a...
No notes.
I won't tell you what Dorothy wrote on the pad.
I didn't write it.
Oh. David wrote it. And it was a nasty. Well, now. Is this something that would contribute to the health of a dog?
Yes.
Could it be considered in some way a vitamin for a dog? And mind you, dogs have, you know, there's A, B, C, D in everything.
No.
No vitamin. Three
dogs
happen to go, Mr. Sir.
Maybe
now,
it is what you said.
If Arlene will subside for a moment.
I will.
Let's try to get some facts here. You say it is consumed, it is not food, and it's solid. And dogs, well, they don't eat it if it's not food. Dogs do swallow it, though.
Yes.
This stream of consciousness is very interesting.
And
we have a question.
And it's not a medicine, you said. It's not medical. It's
not a
medical.
Vitamin. He said.
Not a vitamin. Is it some kind of substance that makes the dog sleeker or bark better or do something to improve his general health and condition?
Yes, I'd say so.
Well, a solid. Would it be called a medicine?
Yes.
Well, what do we have to get if he's
well,
a
what's
dog
the medicine,
medicine,
Benny?
What's the medicine?
Of course. I think what I'll do is throw all the cards over because you could guess all night. And actually, you've done very well. I think Mr. Swartz would agree. They've done very well.
Can we try?
Yeah. Oh. What did you say,
Tranquilizer.
David? Tranquilizer is right. Thank you very much. Mr. Swartz is the sales manager for
Lambert Care Company,
and they make medicines for dogs, and this is a tranquilizer. When you have a dog that's as nervous as a panel member, a dog that's nervous, you give them one of these tranquilizers, and they travel better with them. And,
that's correct.
Don't bite the postman as deeply.
Smaller bite.
And by the way, all the cards are over for the record, and Mr. Swartz has asked that his small scorecard winnings be given to the American Humane Association, and this will be done. And thank you very much.
Thank you.
And of course, the funny part about it is, for the first time in 9.5 years, I recognize the fact that I don't know how these get on here or come off, which is pretty interesting, too. And we'll meet tonight's mystery guest in just a moment, but first, here is a message from our sponsor. We come to the special feature of our program, the appearance of our mystery challenger, for which my friends in the panel are all blindfolded. Blindfolds all in place, panel?
Yes, yes.
Good. Will you come in, mystery challenger, and sign in, please? Our mystery challenger, we go to a different form of questioning. You ask one question at a time, in turn, moving clockwise, and we begin it with Arlene Francis.
Are you a member of the performing arts?
That's right.
Are you, I don't mean just this evening, but are you habitually a comedian? I didn't hear any answer.
Yeah.
Miss Gilgallon.
This is a comedian, we're guessing?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Are you a comedian on the stage in addition to perhaps some other medium?
That's right.
Miss Niven.
Are you in a present Broadway production?
That's right.
Miss Francis.
Would we all be correct in assuming that that is not your native tongue that you're speaking?
That's right. Mr. Sturf.
Is there any music in the play that you're appearing in? Singing, dancing.
That's wrong.
That's wrong. That's one down. Nine to go.
Have you also attained considerable fame and admiration by your work in television?
That's right.
Miss Niven.
Have you, I don't want to be personal, have you ever had any weight problem?
Well, you are.
What did he say?
No, that's wrong.
That's two down and eight to go, Miss Francis.
I'm not too sure of what Bennett was answered before, but are you playing at the present time in a comedy without music?
That's right.
Mr. Sir.
Would this comedy involve a lot of scalawags from the United States Navy?
Oh. That's right.
That's Mr. Poston.
That's right. Say this, that in an era when if you say anything nice about anybody, you're immediately suspect. There is a coincidence here which Bennett, I think, will remember. He called me to insult me on Thursday about something or the other. And he had been to see the Golden Fleecing, which is Tom's show. And a panegyric that lasted 15 minutes. Never had laughed so hard or enjoyed himself. And he said that Phyllis, his wife, had fallen over laughing through the show. So you've got the best walking advertisement for the Golden Fleecing in Bennett Cerf.
That makes two out of the four,
yes,
because there's a young lady on the other end of the panel there who was very sweet. Thank you. Both of you.
Well, Tom,
thank you, Bennett.
You lie
better than she does.
I saw today, it said last couple of weeks or something. I hope this isn't... Well, I think everybody ought to go to see it.
Thank you.
Is this, Tom, now, this is interesting because, you know, I must be impressed with Bennett's attitude. What makes this difference? You must have a very funny program if Bennett says that it's funny and Dorothy thinks it's very funny. I've never heard him so delighted with anything he'd ever done.
Well, perhaps it's because he's going to publish the play.
Well, that's amazing.
Well, yes, I see.
That does offer a certain...
That's a snide remark, Tom.
No, that does happen to be true, but I will say that I don't believe Mr. Cerf would publish a play he wasn't enthusiastic about, and I'm very happy to say that he is enthusiastic about this one. Thank you, Bennett.
Miss Dorothy?
Well, I just wanted to say, John, that I'm absolutely disinterested. I didn't even know the play was going to be published by Bennett. That's how disinterested I am. But I just laughed my head off and loved it, and the whole audience did the night that I saw it. So I recommend it to everyone. The name is The Golden Fleecing.
Right. Well, I must say, I hope that Bennett's news is wrong. Quite honestly, I just hope Bennett's news is wrong. If Bennett and Dorothy can be this enthusiastic about it, it must be a fine and intelligent and very funny play. And you are a fine, intelligent... Yeah, a good German accent. I don't know if you're a fine intelligent... I guess you are.
Why don't you come over and see us?
I'd like to very much. I'm going to go away, but I will do it one of these days. As soon as I can get me through work one night early enough, I will come and
That's
see
right.
you.
That's right, you do work. You don't.
I work all hours of the night. Nice to have you
nice
with us.
Nice to be
Thanks
here.
Thanks very much. Good to see
come
you.
On,
will you say good night to the panel? Well, you have done very well indeed tonight, panel, I must say, and I congratulate you, and we'll be back after this message. Niven, it's been wonderful to have you with us, and I trust you found your level above water or down below water or something, and good night, Miss Dorothy Kilgallen.
Good night, John. Yes, David, you were an absolute stitch. Good night.
Thank you, Dorothy. Good night. Good night, Arlene.
Good night. Happy anniversary.
Thank you.
Whenever it is. Good night, Bennett.
John, I'm on my way to the dentist out in Kansas City, John. Good night.
Bennett, sir, if you ever get to Kansas City, you'll come back a toothless old crow. Good night, ladies and gentlemen. Thanks for being with us on What's My Line.
What's My Line is a CBS Television Network production in association with Mark Goodson and Bill Totten. This program was pre-recorded. Al Sims speaking. brought to you by Kellogg's, the folks who bring the best to you each morning, the widest choice of cereals in the forms you like best. Yours from Kellogg's of Battle Creek. Now let's all play What's My Line? And now let's meet our award-winning panel of What's My Line. First, our publisher panelist, Bennett Cerf.
Miss Arlene Francis is off in Florida trying out a new show, I believe. So in her place tonight, we've got a beautiful young lady, looks like a child to me, who's new to television in this country, new, in fact, to this country. She's an English girl named Eunice Gayson. She's just come here from Let Me Cake in England. Miss Eunice Gayson.
How do you do? And sitting on my right will be an actor who's certainly most popular with us back home in England. I'm sure he's very popular here too, as I know he is. Last year he had a big success on Broadway with Two for the Seesaw, and he's just completed a wonderful new picture, The Crowded Sky, Mr. Dana Andrews.
And on my right, one of the top lady newspaper men of the country who leaves tomorrow morning for the West Coast to cover the Finch trial, Miss Dorothy Kilgallen.
Thank you, Christina. And thank you, ladies and gentlemen. And since everything has turned around tonight, I have, for the first time in the history of What's My Line, the great pleasure of introducing our incomparable moderator, John Wheatley.
And I think we ought to announce right now that there's a new comedy team, Kilgallen and Daly. We just cooked that up. And we're pretty proud of it. I told Dorothy we'd bring the house down. It didn't bring the house down. The house is still up, but it's a cold night, and we're glad anyway. Nice to have Miss Gayson and Mr. Andrews with us tonight. Doesn't change our objectives. We still try to give the panel a difficult time. We'll also have a famous mystery guest before the panel a little bit later in the show, and we'll meet our first challenger after this. And now let's meet our first contestant. Will you come in and sign in, please? Right there. Chan Woo Nam, is that right? I think it's only fair that you should all know this was rehearsed, wasn't it? Mr. Nam, it's very nice to have you with us. Where are you from, sir?
I'm from Seoul, Korea.
Seoul, Korea. Yes. Well, I think you are the first person we've had from Korea, and it's very nice to have you as a guest on What's My Line. May I present our panel, please? Panel, Mr. Nam, will you join me over here, please? Coming from faraway Korea, I wonder if you know how we keep score on this program.
Oh, yes, I do.
You do? All right. If you know how we keep score, there's nothing left to do but tell our audience in the theater and those looking in at home just exactly what your line is. All right, panel, we can tell you that Mr. Nam is salaried, and we'll begin the general questioning with Miss Kilgallen.
Mr. Nam, welcome to the United States, and may I assume that you have nothing to do in any official capacity with the United Nations?
No.
Do you work indoors?